I'm Dr. Vikram Lele. I'm the director of the Department of Nuclear Medicine and PET CT at the Jaslok Hospital and Research Center in Mumbai. Nuclear medicine so far had been thought to be mainly a diagnostic modality, but now in recent years we have moved into the arena of therapy, and there are several cancers which we can treat very well with nuclear medicine. So far we used to treat thyroid cancers with radioactive iodine. Now we have moved into the era of neuroendocrine tumors. These are thought to be rare cancers, but which are more and more prevalent now, and we can diagnose them with a very specific nuclear medicine technique called somatostatin receptor PET CT, which has become available in our country in the last few years, with which we can diagnose the presence and extent of these rare, so-called rare tumors. And once we have diagnosed them, we can treat them with an agent called lutetium dotatate. For this, in the past, we had to send our patients to Europe, where they used to spend something like 30,000 euros for getting treated. Now we can offer this same therapy in India at a cost of maybe 2 lakhs per cycle. So that has been a big advance, and radionuclide therapy for neuroendocrine tumors is now become a fairly established method to treat these sort of hopeless tumors where nothing works. Regular chemotherapy doesn't work. They are usually present in an advanced stage. We have a major role there. So that is one therapeutic advance. And the other advance which is also going to come is in the treatment of lymphomas. Lymphomas which are refractory to the regular conventional chemotherapy can now be treated with lutetium rituximab or iodine rituximab. It's not very new, but in India it has not been practiced, and now we are introducing it, and I'm sure it will be a big boon to patients who are refractory to the regular chemotherapy. So therapy is a big thing, and diagnosis also, there are several new tracers which are coming up for diagnosis of diseases. Now insulinomas, these are another rare tumor which we now have a powerful diagnostic agent called gallium exendin 4. In the past, it used to be a big problem to diagnose these rare tumors, but now with nuclear PET techniques, we can diagnose them very well. And in the realm of neurology, we have these movement disorders, Parkinson's disease, and which we can diagnose very nicely with the help of nuclear technique, where we image these dopamine transporters, which are deficient in Parkinson's disease. As many as 15% of clinically diagnosed Parkinson's disease turn out to have no Parkinson's disease at all. When we do these scans called a technetium DroDAT scan or a DAT scan, dopamine transporter scan, if we find a person who clinically looks like Parkinson's, he's got rigidity, he's got tremors, he's slowed down, but if the DAT scan is normal, then this is not Parkinson's disease, and you will avoid unnecessary long-term therapy with its several side effects. So this is another very useful thing which we introduced a few years ago, and now it has become a fairly important tool in the neurologist's armamentarium to make this diagnosis. And with the combination of a brain PET and this DroDAT scan, we can also differentiate different types of Parkinson's plus syndromes, which can be a major clinical diagnostic problem in its early stages because they resemble several other disease entities. So with the combination of the PET scan of the brain and the DroDAT scan, we can greatly help the neurologists make the correct diagnosis about Parkinson's plus syndromes. And there's a third agent called fluoroethyl tyrosine or FET, which has now been introduced, which will be a great boon in the diagnosis and management of brain tumors. So far, when a brain tumor is treated, the patient is given radiotherapy. After some time, the patient comes back with headache and again probably symptoms of raised pressure. The key question at this point is he having a recurrent disease or is it just a necrosis following the radiation therapy? This distinction is very important to make. And we now have this powerful new fluoroethyl tyrosine, which can pick up a recurrent tumor with great degree of sensitivity. And not only that, it can map out the extent of this tumor. Many of these tumors are interdigitating. And for a radiologist or a radiotherapist, it is necessary to target the tumor very specifically. And with the help of FET, we now have a tool where they can do that. That's another advance. Well, we lack in manpower, we lack in number of centers. For example, a city like Mumbai, in near Jaslok Hospital, you'll probably find some 15 CT scanners. But the whole of India, there are probably 80 to 90 PET CT scanners in the whole country, while there must be thousands of CT scanners and MRIs. So the technology being very expensive, it has not penetrated into the far reaches of the country. So far, it's limited mainly to the major metropolitan cities. And the specialty itself has been around for about 40 years. But because of the lack of number of centers training, it's not moving very rapidly. So the challenges are to make aware the physicians about the utility of this excellent modality. We need to introduce this concept at the basic medical education level. My father is a pioneer of nuclear medicine in the country. He is known as the father of nuclear medicine. He introduced it. But I myself was not much aware of it till I finished my MD. So unless we introduce it into the medical curriculum, then only people will be aware of the great utility of this technique and the amount of good it can do in thyroid diseases and diseases of the heart. We have many people who are having chest pain. We have with nuclear medicine techniques which can distinguish which of these patients should go for bypass surgery, which can be managed medically. Otherwise, everybody nowadays goes for an angiogram. If you find the stenosis, open it up. This has been the paradigm. But now we are realizing that every stenosis need not be opened up. That stenosis has to be shown to cause problem. So with the help of nuclear techniques, we can classify the patients who need to be managed medically and who need to be managed by intervention. So that's one more use which has to be sort of propagated. The challenge is propagating this information. Future is bright because we have several new tracers coming up which will help us to characterize disease at an early stage. It will help us to manage the disease with great degree of confidence. And more youngsters are turning to this field. In my time, we used to take nuclear medicine as a last resort. Now it is considered as one of the first things to go into. So that way, future does look fairly good.